And good evening, everybody. There we go, all set. Now, cheers, everybody. I'll try to make it really special tonight and try to make it worth your while. I've just checked a couple of books and I think they are going to be very interesting. I got some books here from the 18th century, so the 1700s. And I wanted to take you to the real source of the balance spring and show you a bit history, show you the different types, and especially how to adjust hairsprings, the simple do's and don'ts of hairspring adjustment. It can be really, really, really tricky. But if you got just a few rules set for yourself in what to do, in what order, I think it's doable. It's doable for everybody. So please try this at home. Let's show a balance spring. This is an Omega 1943 balance spring with some work. Here we have balance wheel. Show it well every week here on Twitch. But if we zoom into the balance spring, you can see there's something wrong with it. For example, the windings on this side are way closer than on that side. Well, here they are all the same distance. In a moment I'll show you where to begin. Very important. What steps to take, and as always, 42 is a solution, and don't panic is always the best thing to do. Stuff like this is really doable for everybody, and I'll show you the tools to use, and trust me, they're not expensive. So this is the balance spring, and a balance spring is some kind of a hairspring. Well, and here you can see it's a special one. In a moment I'll show you a bit more, because this is the Breguet overcoil balance spring. I will look for some collets so I can show you the do's and don'ts with the collets, because they are very fragile. The collet is the inside here, this bit where the spring is attached. And this is the stud of the Piton and the Virol. A special about balance springs, what they're for, timing, adjustment, and if there's a defect, what to do. The dead simple movement of the Unitas or ETA 64. 97. You can see here there are two important springs in a movement, the main spring and the balance spring. The main spring is where all the power comes from. When you wind a watch, here we are, the basics. This is the ETA watch for training purposes. The two important springs. One is the mainspring, and that is where all the power comes from. And there's underneath here in the main barrel, and there you can see the balance spring, and that is like the pendulum of the clock or the ignition of a car engine. That makes it run on time. Now I wind the mainspring, and the balance spring is starting. Swiss lever escapement, so self-starting escapement. And here you can see the breathing of the balance spring. When you saw the main spring with all the power in it, holds, you wind it, and that's a huge part of a movement. Here you can see the balance spring isn't wound, it's just like a pendulum, it's go back and forth. Wind it a bit more and the amplitude goes up. Christian Huygens, that's the guy in 1658. He was a genius, mathematical, physics, and he wrote down the first physics law, the pendulum law of Huygens. It's important and the real easy way to show how a watch works. The pendulum law of Huygens says that the amplitude has got nothing to do with the timing of a pendulum. Well, and it's very easy to explain. Because, I hope you can hear me, this is the pendulum, goes back and forth, and this is the amplitude of a pendulum. From there to there is 90 degrees, from there to there is 180 degrees. What Huygens came up with is the pendulum law, and he says that tick, tuck, tick, tuck is the same as tick, tuck, tick, tuck. Do you see the amplitude is irrelevant for the timing of a pendulum? Small amplitude, tick, tuck, tick, tuck. Huge amplitude, tick, tuck, tick, tuck. The timing stays the same, and that's incredibly important even in watchmaking, because the pendulum in a clock is exactly the same as the balance spring, like this, the balance spring in a watch. I hope that makes sense. So the amplitude is irrelevant, but there is another way to change the timing of the pendulum. So to change the timing of a pendulum, this is the normal length, but if you make it shorter, it goes faster. If you make it longer, it goes slow. Again, amplitude is irrelevant, but that's the way to change the timing of a pendulum and of the balance spring. And that the pendulum rule is exactly the same for a balance spring. So if you can change the length of the pendulum, make it short, go fast, and make it long, go slow. This is so almost a century after Huygens. Here you can see the first hairsprings. And here you can see that the shape is slightly different than the one we are recognizing today. You can see the verge, the fusée and chain. I love the snack here. But here you can see the timing for the modern pocket watch. Because here you can see, this is the end bit, the stud of the piton, and here you can see the timing pins besides the hairspring. So this bit can go back and forth, and that's exactly the same as the pendulum, making longer and shorter. this one is from the same era, 1755. Again, there you can see the hairspring, balance spring. There. So that is 1755. And again, here, this one is for timing. To make it longer, it goes slow. And make it shorter, it goes fast. Just like the pendulum or the Apple charger I just showed you. So it is being used for a very, very long time. If I move it, I hope you can see here the balance spring. Just a few windings. Can you see it here? Oh, this movement is just about the same age as the books, the mid-1700s. And here you can see the snack and the chain. So the balance spring had a different shape and proportions as the one we use now. And again here, this one is much later than the one I just showed you now. And still just a few windings, but now you can see the earlier balance springs. Here the balance spring, this is the tip, like you're holding the pendulum. And here are two fingers going back and forth the pendulum or balance spring, making it go slow and making it go fast. This is the only normal way of timing a watch, because this balance, well, hasn't got any screws, so cannot lose weight. And the rest is just gears, and the gear ratio doesn't change overnight. There are no teeth falling off or dropping or getting more. So the timing of a watch is only the weight of the balance wheel or the length of the pendulum and the balance spring. And you see the space between the windings is everywhere just about the same. And because you can see what happens if the windings are touching, it goes like this. It goes running forward very fast. Because the pendulum is getting shorter. I hope that makes sense. If windings, with contrast, are touching, then the pendulum suddenly goes a lot shorter and it goes fast. So if a movement is running fast suddenly, usually that's just windings touching each other due to magnetism or oil and grease, and then they're sticky. If a watch suddenly goes slow, there's something else going on, because a movement doesn't suddenly go slow.